Thank you, colleagues. The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 2984 in the name of Karen Adam on celebrating LGBT History Month. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and that will be after we hear from the Minister in response to the debate. And could I take this opportunity to add to what the presiding officer said in extending a very warm welcome back to Minister Christina McKelvey. So I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Karen Adam to open the debate. Karen Adam is joining us remotely. Up to 7 minutes, please, Ms. Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And firstly, I must say that I'm quite envious of everybody being in the chamber with Christina McKelvey today, and I can't wait to get there and see her in person. Welcome back, Christina. I would like to thank all the members cross-party who have supported this motion so that we could bring this debate to Parliament. LGBT History Month this year is focused on the theme Blurring Borders. While some other countries in the world are faced with a rising tide, a rollback really, against LGBT human rights, this SNP government is committed to improving the rights of LGBT people living in Scotland. If we take ourselves back in time up until as recent as 1980, it was illegal to have gay sexual relations, which of course impacted upon any potential romantic or intimate loving relationships. This criminalised generations of LGBT people. And the criminalisation of gay people fed into a culture of shame, which nurtured a hostile environment towards people attracted to the same gender as them, an environment of which we still experience the negative impacts of in our society today. We still have a lot of damage to undo. I have personally felt the impact of the hostile environment which was created. As a child, I had no understanding of my own small world. My mum was gay. I grew up in a household with two women. My mum's partner was referred to as the lodger, and of course, adults gossiped, and this would filter down to their children, who would poke fun at me in the playground, and they'd call out homophobic slurs regarding my mum towards me. I was confused, ashamed, and taught to hide my family circumstances for fear of being bullied. But surely love should never mean having to live in fear. My friends would ask me questions, some prompted by their parents, no doubt, but some, I guess, were just simply curious. But I couldn't answer these questions because I didn't even know what gay was. My mum never spoke about it. School never taught me about it. And we certainly didn't have any healthy examples of gay relationships to pull from. It was only slurs, only shame, and only fear. And in that context, we must remember that in 1988, Margaret Thatcher's UK Tory government implemented a series of laws that prohibited the so-called promotion of homosexuality, in other words, Section 28. So back to this year's theme, Blurring Borders, A World in Motion. Inviting people to think beyond borders and ask each other what Scotland's place is within the global movement towards equality. So let's look at Scotland's record. Since devolution, we have seen some landmark leaps forward in legislation. In 2000, the Scottish Parliament repealed Section 28 and schools can now talk about LGBTI issues with pupils. In 2007, Scottish same-gender couples gained equality in adoption and fostering. In 2014, same-gender marriage is legalised. In 2018, the Historical Sexual Offences, Pardons and Disregards Scotland Act 2018 was introduced. And most recently, in 2021, Scotland introduced LGBT-inclusive education in our schools, a world first. And that is something that I wish I had growing up in the late 70s and 80s. Just imagine how the landscape would have been, well, how it would have differed for so many people. But now at last, this will change the landscape for so more to come. We've improved the rights of LGBT people in this country, but it's also about creating a cultural change in society. All the good laws in the world are all well and good, but we need to also address the unwarranted moral panic going on in the UK right now, particularly towards trans people. And for anyone unfamiliar with the term moral panic, it's a situation that occurs in society in which media reporting has created a folk devil of a particular social group, and it's often minorities or already marginalised people. The expression is described as a moral panic because it is based on an outraged sense of offence. Though the information which prompts said offence is limited, vague, and simply untrue. Folk devils refer to a group whose commonality has become stigmatised by society and becomes a target for adverse comments and behaviour. Just as my own mum and many other lesbian, gay and bi people in the 1980s were demonised and met with suspicion by powerful public figures, politicians and the media. Sadly, in recent years, I recognise the same patterns of discrimination towards LGBT identifying people, but particularly towards trans people, as the Scottish Government have sought to simplify an administrative process, in other words, reforming the GRA. The current rise in LGBT hate crimes is testament to that and the need for culture change. We as citizens and community leaders have a responsibility to have zero tolerance. Otherwise, we become enablers in allowing culture change to the contrary, not just stagnating rights, but rolling back ones already fought for. It is on all of us to act and speak up for what is right, especially cisgendered heterosexual people, to stand by LGBT friends, family, colleagues and loved ones, so that the only culture change in our security, in our society, in our culture is one of acceptance. It is important that we look to take lessons from history so that in future we can ensure those lessons have been learned. What we do here is not only important for the LGBT plus community in Scotland, but it sets an example for the other countries across the globe and LGBT communities worldwide. We should be proud of all that Scotland has done to help lead the way in the fight for LGBT plus equality. We should never underestimate the power our actions and words here can have on the rest of the world. The world is watching. Now it's time for us to lead. I want to take this opportunity today to reaffirm my commitment to improving LGBTQ plus rights and inclusion, particularly as we move forward in reforming GRA, but also very importantly, we need to improve healthcare and outcomes for trans people. Let's go further and let's do more. And finally, Presiding Officer, I want to speak directly with every LGBTQIA plus person that may be listening today. Whether you are out and proud or yet to make that journey, I want to say to you, there is absolutely nothing wrong with you. But there is a lot wrong with the world in which we live in. But know this, I will do everything I can do for my part to create the cultural change needed to ensure that Scotland is a country that is not only safe for you to live true to yourself, but one that leads the world by example. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by David Torrance.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I want to thank my colleague, Karen Adam, who, like me, has long been a proud and unwavering ally of the LGBT community, for securing this debate and allowing us the opportunity to reflect on the past, the present and the future of LGBT rights and the journey that it has taken to get us here. It's hard to reflect on the progress we have made without talking about the contribution of my own party in getting us here. As my colleague Paul O'Kane will say, I'm sure no party has advanced or promoted the rights of LGBT plus community as much as the Labour Party. The Labour Party has been at the front and centre of representation. Maureen Cahoon, the first LGBT plus MP, Chris Smith, the first openly gay MP, Ben Bradshaw and Stephen Twigg, elected on the same night in 1997, became the first MPs to have been selected and then elected while standing as openly gay candidates. And Dame Angela Eagle, the first out lesbian serving UK government minister. These politicians, their bravery in putting themselves forward, then fighting the fight once they got there, are the reason that today LGBT MPs sit right across the UK government chamber. Here in Scotland too, Kezia Dugdale was one of the first openly gay leaders of the Scottish Labour Party. And during the time of her leadership, Ruth Davidson and other openly gay women led the Scottish Conservatives. It was said at the time that this parliament was the gayest parliament in the world. That time of Scottish political history may be clouded by intense political periods that surrounded it, but I am sure that one day we will look back and we will recognise just how pivotal a moment that was. And now in this new Parliament, I'm proud to make my contribution alongside my good friend Paul O'Kane, the first openly gay man to be elected as a Scottish Labour MSP, and to see the positive trend of LGBT representation continue across this chamber. We cannot underestimate the importance of seeing people just like you, to know that you too can be in the room, and I know that myself only too well. And sexuality or gender should never be a barrier to someone's progression or achievements. But sadly, too often it is, and so we cannot be complacent, even here in Scotland, where we pride ourselves in being progressive. We are still far behind my vision of being the best place to grow up for LGBT plus people. Sexual orientation is still the second most commonly reported motivator for hate crime, and that figure has been rising over the past 10 years. One in five LGBT people have been the victims of hate crime, motivated by their gender identity or sexual orientation, and that figure jumps to almost half of trans people. The fights won are many, but there are still many to fight. And I make a commitment today, as I have before, that I will stand shoulder to shoulder with the LGBT community through the battles that lie ahead. We learned yesterday that the Scottish Government intends to finally bring forward a bill to reform the Gender Recognition Act next week, and it is long overdue. I stand ready, alongside my colleagues, to support reform and to scrutinise the bill to ensure that it delivers the change needed, where transgender people no longer have to endure intrusive, degrading and medicalised intervention just to identify in the gender they are. I say to the Cabinet Secretary that in delaying action, the Government has, however, created a vacuum which has allowed fear and ignorance to prosper. In all discussions I have had about this legislation, it's become clear to me that the delay has allowed people's imaginations to run wild, to imagine that reform is something it is not, and to allow a narrative to build which frames the rights of trans people as a threat to women, as if those two things are mutually exclusive. Meanwhile, the number of hate crimes against trans people has been rising, having risen significantly since 2016 when the proposals for this bill were first floated. I know the Cabinet Secretary shares my frustration with this, and I hope she will do all she can in the weeks ahead to settle concerns, correct misunderstandings, and move forward with legislation in a way that protects trans people from further harm or abuse. I started this debate celebrating the importance of progress made and of representation. And I know that all of us here speaking in this debate this afternoon want to be on the right side of history. And that means unapologetically and unequivocally standing up for and protecting the rights of all LGBT people in Scotland. And I, for one, will do all I can from these benches to do just that. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call David Torrens to be followed by Tess White. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I would like to congratulate Karen Adamson for securing this debate tonight in Parliament. And can I also say to Christina, it's great to have you back, and you've been sorely missed by all of us. I am honoured to participate in this debate to mark LGBT History Month 2022 and to have the opportunity to reflect on the past and present of the LGBT community, celebrate LGBT progress and to address the injustices still experienced by far too many around the globe. Every February, the UK comes together to celebrate the history of its LGBT plus citizens and to raise awareness about ongoing issues still faced by the LGBT plus community. And this year, the theme is Blurring Borders, A World in Motion. Scotland quite rightly prides itself on being one of the most progressive countries when it comes to issues on sexuality and gender identity. It now seems incomprehensible, but until 1980, homosexuality between men was still illegal. I am extremely proud of the Scottish Government's work, not only to progress equality, but the right to historic wrongs. The passing of the landmark historic sexual offence legislation was a monumental step and a very proud day in this chamber that I won't forget. Whilst it can never erase the hurt, injustice and trauma caused to thousands of men, it does send a very clear message that these laws were unjust, morally unfair and discriminatory, and that this is a government and the people of Scotland that recognise the value and diversity and culture of our LGBT plus community. We have the most progressive and extensive equal marriage legislation, equal access to adoption, IVF for same-sex couples. We have formed a blood donation rules, removing deferment period for some gay and bisexual men from donating blood and place it with an individual risk assessment regardless of sexual orientation, allowing thousands of gay and bisexual men to donate blood for the first time. We were the first country to host the Transgender Intersex Conference, bringing people together from across the UK to work on and prove transgender and intersex equality. We recently became the first country in the world to embed LGBT plus inclusive education in our schools, meaning that learning about LGBT plus history and culture is not restricted to 1 month of the year. However, as we stand here today and celebrate an inclusive and diverse country that we are all lucky to live in, we cannot ignore that homosexuality is still criminalised in over 60 countries around the world. The international focus on this year's History Month has shone a spotlight on what the equal world of LGBT people would really look like and how we can work together to achieve it. A study by the Yale School of Public Health identified our global closet and reported that an estimated 83% of those who identified as lesbian, gay or bisexual keep their orientation hidden from all or most of the people in their lives. This may sound unimaginable to us, but when you consider that in some countries homosexuality continues to be punishable by imprisonment or forced labour, revealing one's true self can often be a matter of life or death. In a blog written by LGBT History Month by Stonewall's Director of Global Programmes, Leanne McMillan, speaks of the difficulties faced by those seeking to escape legal discrimination, entrenched homophobia and heteronormativity. Our vision is of a world where everyone is free to be ourselves, but the truth is that in many areas of the world, simply being LGBTQ+ puts your life at risk. We know that nobody would leave their home country, risking their life and livelihoods, and leaving behind them a world they built for themselves, unless they had no other option. The journeys they embarked upon to reach safer shores are grueling and fraught with risk, and the reality is that when, or if they reach sanctuary, the challenges are far from over. The trauma refugees experience before doing and fleeing their home countries is hard to comprehend for those of us who have always lived in a relative safety. But make no mistake, it isn't just the laws that need change. We know even in countries where equal laws exist that lesbian, gay, bi and trans people continue to face discrimination on a daily basis, with people often finding themselves excluded or facing verbal and physical abuse at work, schools, in sport or within their local communities. Presiding officer, love comes in many forms and it is our duty to stand up and challenge discrimination, end injustice based on sexual orientation and gender identity whenever and wherever we see it.
Thank you. I now call on Tess White to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms White.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm delighted to speak in this Members' Business Debate, and I thank Karen Adam for giving MSPs the opportunity to celebrate and reflect on LGBT history in the Chamber today. Each year, LGBT Youth Scotland creates the theme for LGBT History Month. In February 2022, the theme is Blurring Borders, a world in motion. It challenges us to reflect on the journey towards equality around the world and the pace of change in different countries. This theme has particular resonance for me. As an HR director, a key consideration when moving people and their families around the world for work is the kind of culture and environment they will be living and working in. Time and time again, it brings into sharp relief that the rights we have here in the UK are not universally shared. This is so important for the LGBT community because there are 69 countries where it is still illegal to be gay. In Brunei, Iran, Mauritania, Saudi Arabia, Yemen, and the northern states in Nigeria, the punishment is the death penalty. In these countries, LGBT people live in constant fear of being outed, a sobering reminder that while the UK and Scotland have made so much progress, there is so much progress to be made elsewhere. Even in countries where LGBT people are no longer criminalised, marriage equality remains an issue. Same-sex marriage is legal in 31 countries, but it is unlawful in many more. It means that gay couples often do not have the same rights in law as heterosexual married couples, an injustice so painfully and poignantly explored in the film sequel If These Walls Could Talk, when Edith was unable to be at the bedside of her partner, Abby, as she died, and was asked by Abby's family to leave the home where they had shared for 30 years. This is still the awful reality for many same-sex couples who are unable to marry. The Netherlands was, of course, the first country to legalise gay marriage in 2001. The Marriage Same-Sex Couples Bill passed in England and Wales in July 2013, which David Cameron described as one of his proudest moments. Scotland followed suit in December 2014, and I still remember seeing pictures of the incredible celebrations of love that followed the change in the law. In Scotland and the UK, we have made great strides towards equality, but there is still so much more that must be done. Next week, the University of Dundee will host an event commemorating Jonathan Leslie, who took his own life in Stonehaven 2 years ago following intense homophobic harassment. Jonathan's passing is a tragic reminder that we can't be complacent and that equality in the law does not always mean equality in another's eyes. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Paul O'Kane. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I add my voice to those who've already welcomed Christine McKelvey back to the Chamber this evening? I congratulate and thank Karen Adam for lodging this motion and securing this debate today. It is so important to have the opportunity to stand up in solidarity with LGBTQI plus people. That's what allyship is all about. The Scottish Greens are proud to have always supported wholeheartedly LGBTQI rights and to have been part of the many campaigns we've heard about this evening already. LGBT History Month matters. This month gives us the chance to celebrate diversity, to recognise difference and to embrace it. It also allows us to celebrate the victories that have been won. It was not that long ago that homosexuality was a criminal offence in this country. This Parliament should be proud of the role it has played in enhancing the rights of LGBTQI plus people, abolishing Section 28, bringing in equal marriage, supporting trans-inclusive education, enabling gay men to give blood, and so much more. And I recognise that all of these victories were the result of tireless campaigning by LGBTQI plus people and their allies. It is right that we remember these victories tonight and those who fought for them. And it is also right that we remember those who suffered the consequences, the trauma, the violence, the harm, and the grief associated with participating in those fights or living in the world before they were won. And this also means we can learn more about the histories of LGBTQI plus communities that have been ignored, erased, or altered in the past because of prejudice and bigotry. LGBTQI plus identities have existed for as long as humans have, but they are seldom mentioned in history books. Erasing people's lives is not okay. And this month, we can learn what we have missed out on because of this erasure. Making these identities visible now matters, and it matters deeply. Letting people see themselves reflected in society is important. Education is a key part of this, but so too is ensuring our leaders, our workplaces, our culture, and so much more reflect the diversity of our society. It is important that we take a moment to remember all of those still fighting for equality and access to rights. Too many countries around the world still criminalise same-sex relationships, and research shows that trans and gender-diverse people face disproportionate hate crime and violence. We know that recent evidence in Scotland shows rising victimisation and targeting of people based on gender and sexuality. None of this is inevitable, and together we can change it. I was delighted to take part in Dundee Pride and Shaper Capers Outfest Question Time at the weekend, along with colleagues Jo Fitzpatrick, Mercedes Villalba and Willie Rennie. I'd like to think that across this chamber, we can agree that organisations like Dundee Pride and Four Pillars in Aberdeen do vital work supporting LGBTQI communities. And their support, campaigning and activism is not for February alone, but for every day of the year. I'd like to pay tribute to them for their tireless work. Ultimately, Presiding Officer, LGBT History Month allows us to stand in solidarity with the LGBTQI plus community, to learn how to be better allies and better equalities campaigners, and to pay homage to those who have paved the way for the rights and freedoms we enjoy today. It reminds us of those who were erased, ignored, murdered because of their identity. And it requires us not to be complacent, to keep fighting, to keep challenging discrimination and inequalities of power wherever they occur, because we still have much work to do. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Jamie Green. Up to... I don't call Alex Cole-Hamilton. I actually call Paul O'Kane, and I thank the clerk for keeping me in order. And up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I apologise to you and colleagues that I will have to leave before the conclusion of the debate. Can I also welcome Christina McKelvey back to Parliament and begin my contribution by thanking Karen Adam for bringing this debate to the Chamber and pay tribute to her as an ally of LGBT plus people, along with many other colleagues who are participating this evening. I am pleased to be able to speak in this debate as we celebrate LGBT plus History Month. And I am pleased to be able to use that word celebrate, because this month should be a celebration. All too often lately, it has felt as though the rights of many LGBT plus people and the hard-won progress that has been made over many years has been up for debate. And we know that crimes aggravated by sexual orientation prejudice in Scotland have risen by 32% from 2018-19 to 2020-21. And according to Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service data, on charges reported, while hate crimes aggravated by transgender identity prejudice, they have doubled since 2015. The Council of Europe has recently pointed to the UK as being among several countries where the advances of recent years are under threat, amid extensive and often virulent attacks on the rights of LGBT plus people. And we know that too many LGBT plus people tragically take their own life or contemplate doing so. I've spoken in this chamber before about my young self and the fears I felt when growing up. But I have also reflected on the amazing progress made and the confidence given to me by people across this country who stood up and spoke out, particularly in this place. And I am immensely proud of the record of my party. Decriminalisation, equalising the age of consent, lifting the ban on lesbian, gay men and bi people in the military, repealing Section 2A, commonly known as Section 28, the Gender Recognition Act, civil partnerships paving the way to equal marriage, adoption rights, the Equality Act. So I want to say tonight to any young LGBT people watching this debate, you're not alone. You may be worried just now. The world around you might seem terrifying. All you might see and read is what seems like sometimes a never-ending onslaught of anti-LGBT plus rhetoric. But it gets better, and it will get better. And there are people in this place standing up for you, and speaking out for you, and ready to defend all of the progress we have made and to move forward once again in the journey for equality. To quote my esteemed colleague in the House of Commons, Dame Angela Eagle MP, we aren't going to get back in the closet or hide or be ashamed of the way we are. We will help write the next pages of our history, and the young people of today will pick up that torch and carry it on. So there is more to do. There is always more to do. Continuing progress on inclusive education, banning the horrendous practice of so-called conversion therapy, reforming the Gender Recognition Act, and improving access to healthcare and services for trans people. The theme, as we have already heard this evening, of LGBT History Month 2022 is Blurring Borders, a World in Motion, and we are invited to reflect beyond our own borders. I think given the challenges and perils in our world at this very moment, it is so important to do so. Our debate in Parliament yesterday on the Borders and Immigration Bill has naturally made me think of LGBT plus refugees around the world fleeing persecution, violence and death in their home countries. And the unfolding situation in Ukraine and the fears for the progress and rights of LGBT plus people and their safety should be at the forefront of all of our minds. Because the history of LGBT plus people is a global story, a story of solidarity, of understanding and of love. I'm inspired by so many Scots who have led the way. And I'm also inspired by amazing organisations like Stonewall Scotland, LGBT Youth Scotland, Time for Inclusive Education, the Equality Network and others. But I'm also inspired by global figures, such as Harvey Milk. I have a quote of his on my desk upstairs. Hope will never be silent. Know that it won't. For as long as I stand in this place, and for as long as I have my voice, hope will never be silent. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Jamie Green. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Cole-Hamilton.
Well, Thank you very much, and I'm glad you did call Paul Kane, their presiding officer, for an excellent contribution. I'm very grateful to hear particularly the words of Harvey Milk at the end of his statement. Can I start by welcoming Christina McKelvey back to her place? It's great to see you and have your sparkle back in the chamber, Christina. And thanks to Karen Adam for bringing this important debate today, and also for her very moving account of growing up to gay parents. And I just think it was a beautiful account of how far we have come, and I thank her for it. Also want to thank the many organisations who've contributed with briefings today and for the work that they do right across the board, particularly with LGBT young people and helping them find themselves and their place. Presiding Officer, in his iconic novel Giovanni's Room, gay author James Baldwin makes a powerful statement about love. And I quote, "Love him and let him love you. Do you think anything else under heaven really matters?" His words resonated at the time with millions of people who felt like their love was invalid because of the gender of the person that they loved. It is, or it has been, a long march towards LGBT equality in Scotland. And though we have come far, there is still work to be done. We've heard lots of that this evening. And I'm sure everyone feels and knows that they are valid and accepted no matter who they are or how they love, but that doesn't happen everywhere. LGBT History Month rightly reminds us of some of the key moments on that road to equality. Gay people in Scotland long lived under the shadow of the Criminal Law Amendment Act, which made male sex a criminal offence carrying a 2-year prison sentence, which wasn't fully overturned in Scotland until 1981. And in 1988, as we have heard several times already, Section 28, or Clause 2A, was introduced to prevent teachers from even talking about LGBT plus issues in schools, causing many vital support groups to close as a result, with local authorities fearing that they might be in breach of the law, allowing them to continue. We only got rid of that in 2000, as we've heard. Yes, we have been on quite a journey towards rights for LGBT people in this country. We are now rightly proud as a nation to hold the mantle as, and I quote, the best country in Europe for LGBTI equality. Indeed, one of my proudest moments during my time was actually sat alongside Christina McKelvey in the Equality and Human Rights Committee last session when we stewarded through this Parliament a bill that would end, or rather extend, a formal apology from the state to all gay men who had long had to bear the stain of a criminal record for acts or for being intimate with the person that they love, crimes that are no longer an offence. Presiding Officer, while we have come a long way and while we should be rightly proud, we must not forget what's still to be done. LGBT people face still a number of barriers which pop up right across our society, from healthcare to education. Some of these barriers are blatant, some are more subtle, but they all cause damage and harm to those people on a daily basis, and they need to be addressed. That's why my party recommends that steps be taken to help healthcare professionals and social care workers recognise LGBT-specific issues, particularly around trans health issues and how they need to be addressed. It's also time that we redouble our efforts for LGBT-inclusive education. And indeed, the final frontier of LGBT equality is in trans rights. In the coming months, this Parliament will debate GRA reform, and I think it is right that we use the opportunity that we have to hear evidence, reflect and scrutinise the legislation that passes through this chamber. But the GRA does need reformed. It is harming people every single day. We must make sure that we are able to improve laws that will better support trans people to live their lives free from discrimination. Presiding Officer, I'd like to end with a quote from Anthony Venn Brown, himself a survivor of conversion therapy, which we across this chamber have called to be banned. And I quote, "The richness, beauty and depths of love can only be fully experienced in a climate of complete openness, honesty and vulnerability." Well, I am proud as a Liberal, and to be a Liberal is my heartfelt belief that everyone should be empowered to be who they truly are fully and who love who they love freely. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Due to the number of members who wish to speak in this debate, I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. I now invite Karen Adam to move a motion without notice. Ms. Adam.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Moved. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. I now call Jamie Green to be followed by Paul McLennan. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Green.
Thank you. And don't worry, I won't speak for 30 minutes. Can I start by thanking Karen Adam for today's debate? It's great to see her wearing her rainbow braces. I remember a time when we were asked to remove rainbow ties for wearing them in the chamber because they were a campaigning symbol. How times have changed, how this Parliament indeed has changed. I should declare an interest as founder and co-convener of the Parliament's LGBTI cross-party group, and I'm really pleased to welcome new members to this session's Parliament as part of that group. I think I would just start by saying that the LGBTI community as such is not one homogenous group. We are all different. We have different beliefs, backgrounds, views, and, as you can see, politics. We are different. But we're different and the same because we come through the same history. And history is a journey to where we are. And my goodness, what a journey it has been. Right back in 1533 was the first Buggery Act, which was punishable by death. Well, today, you can still be put to death for being gay. In 1885, the Criminal Law Amendment Act made same-sex acts illegal. In 70 countries, that's still the case today. In fact, it took in Scotland until 1980, the year I was born, before we reversed these draconian laws. And full age of consent equality did not take place until 2000. And it's hard to imagine we're having this debate at a time in the context when it was illegal for me to be with my then partner. Progress, of course, is welcome. And I was proud to be part of the gayest parliament in the world, as Pam Duncan-Glancy put it. But I wouldn't be standing here making a speech like this today if so many hadn't fought for my right to do so. The Gay Liberation Front in the US, which grew out of the ashes of the Stonewall riots, and groups like Outrage, Olga, Daft, the Sisters of Perpetual Indulgence, and the Lesbian Avengers. Not phrases you often hear in this parliament, but there was nothing amusing about what they were doing. It was courageous, it was gritty, and it was dangerous. And amongst the many names of pioneers and revolutionaries that I could name today, there are too many to list, but I do want to single out one, and that's Peter Tatchell. And I hope my praise is not unwelcome, because I speak as a gay man who is thanking him personally, not as a politician, but he does deserve my thanks. When he stood as a Labour candidate for Bermondsey in 1981, it was a disgusting campaign, blatant homophobia that he faced. And that, yes, that was against the backdrop of Section 28, the most shameless episode in our political history. Now, he and I may disagree on many issues, but his direct action undeniably contributed towards progress here and elsewhere. And I guess that's where I move on to today. You know, this world was shaken by murders like that of Matthew Shepherd back in 1998, horrific abuse and torture, words which I wouldn't even mention because for fear the official report would have to write them down. But are we still shaken by events like that? Are we shaken by the murder of Samuel Leith last year, a 24-year-old young boy in Spain who was beaten to death? That sparked national outrage and protests right across Spain. What about the death of Dr. Gary Jenkins in Cardiff, who was beaten to death around the same time? You know, the CCTV picked up his last moments, and he was heard crying out, "Please help me, stop it, and why?" Well, why indeed? Where was the outrage after Gary's death? Where were the national protests? Where are the protests that 1 in 10 young LGBT Scots have tried to take their own life? Where is the protests in this country that hate crime is on the rise against LGBTI people? Sometimes I wish I had the guts that Peter Tatchell had the year that I was born. And let me conclude by saying the battles that we now face are no less divisive, no less difficult, no less ugly, but no less important. Because first, we must ban conversion therapy, somehow. And we must do it in a way which has no unintended consequences to the rights and freedoms which we all enjoy, but neither should it be watered down or diluted under the pretense of those rights. And second, we must reform gender recognition in a way where no one is weeshed, but in a way which also asks each and every one of us to put ourselves in the shoes of a young trans person right now, today in Scotland, waiting 44 months for treatment. Walk a mile in someone's shoes and then judge them, I say. The same arguments used in the bygone days against consent, against gay marriage, against Section 28, against gay adoption, they're all being churned back up again. They're all being wrapped up in sensibility and coated in a modern middle-class outrage. But these are no less visceral, nonetheless. I close on a plea to each and every one of us, a plea for respect. Because when we lose respect for each other, we lose the argument. When we lose the argument, we lose hope. And sometimes hope is all we have, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Paul McLennan to be followed by Michael Mara. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Karen Adam for bringing this member's debate today? And again, just great to see Christina back in the chamber. Look forward to working with her in the months and years ahead. And I have to say, the speeches so far have been absolutely fantastic and very, very moving. I want to thank Ty and LGBT Youth for the briefings for this. And in their briefing, LGBT Youth said that Scotland's vision is that Scotland is the best place to grow up for lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender and intersex young people. And that's a challenge to us all. LGBT History Month takes place in February every year and offers a chance to connect and reflect on the past. And President of the LGBT community, and Maggie Chapman made the point that this isn't just about the debate today. We have to live this every single day, and we've got a role to play, and that equality drives us all forward in that reflection, and we have to remember that. LGBT Youth, I met with them probably about 2 or 3 weeks ago and was moved around about the work that they do, and obviously it's a national charity, and they work with LGBTI young people from 13 to 25 across Scotland, and it was great to chat with them and actually hear about the work that they're doing and the impact they're making on individual people. They obviously deliver face-to-face and online youth work services. They've got the LGBT charter programme for schools and organisations, and their youth work to make sure young people's voices are heard by decision-makers is incredibly important. We celebrate the work that they do. I think it's been touched upon that this year's theme is about blurring borders, a world in motion. This year, we are invited to think beyond borders. And as we heard, we're lucky to live in Scotland and other parts in the world. People are persecuted just for their sexuality, about who they are. Now, Scotland has made great strides towards equality. We've heard about that already. The journey has come at a slower pace in some parts of the world and faster than others. And again, when I reflected on the discussion in the meeting with LGBT, they mentioned LGBT youth. They talked about a lot of young people have been denied the opportunity to learn about themselves, their history, and see what people are like reflected in the school curriculum. I was heartened last week by the support for GRA reform, and it showed a large majority in support of reforms. And I look forward to debating that when it comes forward next week. From September last year, the Scottish Government began to implement LGBT inclusive education across all our schools. And that means young people across Scotland get to learn about LGBT history, notable moments, key figures, role models. And we can be part of the role models as well as learning about prejudice and discrimination, rights and seeing representations of diverse families that can spoke about earlier on, including same-sex parents and relationships in their learning. The purpose of LGBT inclusive education is to take a proactive educational approach to tackling prejudice and bullying that we've heard that LGBT young people suffer now. And I hadn't heard the figure before when we mentioned about 1 in 10 gay people talking about taking their own lives. That's a horrendous figure, an incredibly horrendous figure, and we should be moving to try the best we can to make sure that no gay person feels in that position at all. All young people deserve to see themselves reflected in learning at school. Learning about LGBT past and present figures at school provides young people with role models, as I said, makes them feel valued about who they are, and they should be confident and proud about who they are. LGBT History Month can be a powerful opportunity for reflection and awareness raising. Learning about LGBT history should be all year round, not only in February. It's not only impactful for LGBT young people, but also for the wider community, the school community. It teaches about empathy, improves understandings of prejudice and discrimination, and it builds knowledge around about diversity and rights in our own society. The pupil workshops, I think, that Ty mentioned for primary and secondary school covers themes of challenging homophobic language. And far too easy, we hear throwaway comments that obviously affects people and hurts people. Analysis of their work, and this is the key thing, even just since September, analysis of their work found that 93% of pupils who participated in the school workshops had a stronger understanding of the impact of homophobic, biphobic and transphobic bullying behaviours and prejudice than before. 93%. 82% said they would no longer use pejorative language and slurs that are commonly used, such as "that's so gay" and derogatory terms. In their own words, people who participated said they had learned it's okay to be LGBT, you shouldn't be scared to tell anyone about who you are and not to bottle things up. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I encourage all of us to come together, reflect on the power of the people and the strength of the solidarity across the borders and support for the LGBT community. I'm proud to do so. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Michael Mara, who will be the last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to relate the story of one gay Scottish man, but in reality, this is a story about one written letter. A letter written by Harry White, a gay working class Edinburgh man born in 1907, a son of a house painter who made a life as a journeyman journalist. As such, writing was his daily trade. But writing this one letter from his typewriter was an act of breathtaking bravery. Writing it risked almost certain death. The letter he wrote from his Moscow desk in May 1934 was to one Joseph Stalin, a letter that Stalin duly read. Harry was a communist, a far more common thing for Scots in the 1930s than it is today. But by 1934, at the age of 27, he worked in Russia at the Moscow Daily News. On March 7th of that year, the Soviet criminal code was revised to prohibit male homosexuality, with up to 5 years hard labour as a penalty. Harry White was outraged. I've today placed a copy of his letter in Spice. Any members who care to read it will see that the letter to the Supreme Leader is in a very formal Soviet style. It's a model of discourse that would have been well known to many Scots, a way of writing and speaking we can only now really hear faint echoes of in how we discuss life, economics and politics. And you can see it perhaps in the words of Mick McGahey of Jimmy Reid. The letter analyses the economic weight of a non-reproductive population. It talks the language of socialist state jurisprudence. But at its core here, in an impassioned plea for equality written under the threat of death. In these words, I have always believed that it was wrong to advance the separate slogan of the emancipation of working-class homosexuals from the conditions of capitalist exploitation. I believe that this emancipation is inseparable from the general struggle for the emancipation of all humanity. Harry White then argues that homosexuality is natural, that it cannot be reversed. In his words, the law is absurd and unjust from the viewpoint of science, which has proven the existence of constitutional homosexuals and has no means at its disposal to change the sexual nature of homosexuals. Harry White was quite clear a century ago on both the science and the morality of conversion therapy. And this is certainly the letter of a young man in certainty, self-confidence and righteous fervour. To Harry, he was gay and he was a socialist. These were core to his understanding of who he was, his place in the world. And the reality of his homosexuality eventually leads to his better understanding of the nightmare fictions of Stalinism, the horror of communism, the terror of absolute power of the state over the individual. In perhaps the most startling passage of this letter, Harry White quotes back Comrade Stalin's own words against him from his report to the 17th Party Congress. And this actually took my breath away. One cannot require that all people should have identical needs and tastes, that all people live their daily lives according to a single model. To conclude from this that socialism requires the egalitarianism, equalisation and levelling of the needs of society's members, the levelling of their tastes and personal lives, that according to Marxism, everyone should wear identical clothes and eat the same quantity of one and the same dishes, is tantamount to uttering banalities. What an act of defiance from one man, one Scot, in Moscow. It brought to my mind the shadow life lived by Shostakovich, who lived in the fear of the music in his mind and whether he would suffer in Russia for giving it life on a page. Well, Harry wrote it all down. Stalin wrote on the letter from Harry White these short words, archive, an idiot and a degenerate, J. Stalin. Harry White escaped just with his life, but not with his communism. So why does this history matter? Well, it matters tonight to thousands of gay men and women in Kiev and across the Ukraine. Vladimir Putin calls on this history, on nationalism, on populism, and a poisonous strongman masculinity. Putin's campaign of state-sanctioned violence and intimidation of gay men and women in Russia calls out to a folk memory of communism. Today's dictator who wages war in Europe again calls to history. Harry White saw Joseph Stalin. Harry White would see Vladimir Putin. We know who Vladimir Putin is, and Harry White knew too.
Thank you. And I now call on Minister Christina McKelvey to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I extend my grateful thanks to you, the Presiding Officer, and the other Deputy Presiding Officer for your warm welcome back to the Chamber tonight, to all of you who have hung about the night and everybody who has been sending me messages to welcome me back. I'm back in my place. And I'm so pleased to be here, and I'm so grateful for the warm welcome. You'll never understand how grateful I am, but I am anyway. I'm really delighted to be closing this debate. It's a perfect debate for me to come back to, all of its, you know, focus and thought-provoking contributions from members across the chamber tonight. And Paul O'Kane and his contribution reminded, this is a celebration and we should be celebrating the progress that we've made, but not forgetting the progress we've still to make. All speakers tonight have highlighted the great progress we've made as a country and reminded us that those rights have to be both won and kept. But we still need to do more to make Scotland a truly inclusive country for all LGBTI people. Karen Adam, Pam Duncan Clancy and Maggie Chapman reminded us that this Parliament, since its inception, since 1999, has always sought to advance the rights of LGBTI people. And LGBTI equality is a priority for me as a minister, as well as being very close to my heart as an individual. It's vital that equality is achieved, not just here in Scotland, but also beyond. And this year's LGBT History Month theme, as we've heard, is Blurring Borders. That encourages us to come together and consider the experience of LGBT people across the world. And Mike O'Mara's eloquent telling of the story of Harry White's letter to Stalin, what a brave man he was. But he reminds us of the dangerous battles fought for equality and the dangerous battles still to fight when we speak about Russia and the worries of the people in Ukraine. 100 years on, and we are still fighting those battles we have work to do. David Torrance gave us an important reminder to celebrate our achievements as a nation and to be proud of Scotland as a place where LGBTI rights and people and their rights are realised and where everyone's identity is respected and celebrated. Now, we know that that doesn't happen all the time and in every sphere, but we need to keep advancing that so that it does. David Torrance also reminded us of the precarious and sometimes dangerous situations that LGBTI people find themselves around the globe, even to this day. So we must continue to work hard to ensure that no one is denied rights or opportunities because of their gender identity or sexual orientation. And I believe that our policies and actions at home should be reflected on the world stage. Tess White gave us stark figures of the countries around the world where it being LGBTI is still a criminal offence, and in some cases, the death penalty is the action that's taken against them. Scotland has received international recognition for a progressive approach to LGBT equality, which is in no small part down to the exceptional work of the LGBT community, its organisations, its activists who have fought for equality and human rights over the past decade, and can I also say across parties, across this chamber since 1999 as well. LGBT History Month is a cornerstone of this work. It's an opportunity for us to celebrate how far we've come, the lessons we've learned along the way, and to understand the obstacles and the challenges still ahead of us. I'd like to thank LGBT Youth Scotland, like many others, for coordinating this year's History Month. This is a key event in our calendars and one that I look forward to every year. This year, there's been a large number of events, both online and in person, across the country throughout February, culminating on Friday with the annual fundraising Purple Friday Day. And I did buy one of those fabulous LGBT Scotland T-shirts with a Highland cow with the rainbow fringe. I'm wearing it on Friday. And can I say to Maggie Chapman, Dundee Pride, wonderful. I'm looking forward to coming back to that. A wee bit more about Scotland's achievements, because Scotland wants to remain on the right side of history on this. We want to continue to set world-leading examples, whether it's about equality, protection from discrimination or inclusion, and I believe that Scotland has embraced this responsibility for many years. Scotland has led the way in marriage equality, legalising civil partnerships in 2005 and introducing same-sex marriage in 2014, a proud moment to press my button that night and vote for that. And in 2018, along with Alec Cole-Hamilton, we've seen the Historic Pardons Bill put through the Parliament. This pardoned men previously convicted of same-sex activity under obsolete laws, which have now been repealed. We took some private evidence from some amazing men who had convictions, and they just wanted to make sure that the world is a better place for the other generations coming in. It was great to hear from them to do that, and it was a brilliant piece of work to do in our committee at the time. So, ongoing work, because we've talked about the work that we've already done, we've got much, much more to do. Ongoing work through recognising important contributions that LGBT people and their movements have made throughout history, and by promoting awareness of issues faced by the LGBT community, their importance will be properly recognised. If we take inclusive education, my thanks as always goes to the Thai campaign, Jordan and Liam, for their enduring commitment to inclusive education. It's vitally important that this effort starts with children and young people, particularly as LGBT children can experience difficulties because of their sexual orientation or gender identity. So in September last year, we became the first country in the world to embed LGBT inclusive education. Pam Duncan Clancy and Paul McLennan said we must work together to make Scotland the best place to grow up. I think we can do that and live up to that aspiration. We must live up to that aspiration. Many speakers, presiding officer, spoke about healthcare, and I want to really quickly just touch on a point. We recognise the need to improve access to and delivery of gender identity services. In December, we published an NHS Gender Identity Services Strategic Action Framework, which describes how we will fund work to address waiting times, multidisciplinary care, and support for those waiting for access to services, and I give my commitment to continue doing that work and working with health colleagues. Many speakers raised gender recognition reform, so next week we will introduce the gender recognition bill to improve the process for trans people to obtain legal recognition of their acquired gender, and Social Justice Cabinet Secretary Shona Robinson will give a parliamentary statement on that. These proposals have led to discussion and debate, and we know that there are those who support reform and those who have concerns. The bill does not introduce any new rights for trans people or change the protections provided within the Equality Act. Our support for trans rights does not conflict with our continued commitment to uphold and advance women's rights and equalities. While there is disagreement on these issues, it's vital that we work together to set a tone of respectful discussion, as Jamie Green spoke about. We've also committed, and Jamie Green raised this in his contribution as well, that this year we will take the necessary steps to end conversion practices in Scotland. We are clear that these are abhorrent, harmful and discriminatory practices and have no place in our society. By the end of next year, we will introduce legislation that is as comprehensive as possible within our devolved powers in bringing about a ban, and I'm happy to work with anyone across the parties in doing that. We will establish an expert advisory group to support this ambition, and the membership will be finalised shortly, and I'll let members know about that. Touching on another issue that came up in the debate around about hate crime, Karen Adams spoke very eloquently about the experiences of her mum and reminded us that hate against LGBTI people is still prevalent. So, we will also work with key delivery partners and stakeholders to publish a new hate crime strategy that will build upon progress made in tackling prejudice in Scotland and look to how we better foster cohesion between our myriad of communities and social groups to confront the forces that seek to drive us apart. And while a rise in recorded levels of hate crime may reflect increased confidence in reporting of such crimes to the police, it is never acceptable and will not be tolerated. Maggie Chapman and other speakers highlighted the rise in hate crime. Paula Kane reminded us about the Council of Europe report, and Jamie Green reminded us that 1 in 10 young people have said they consider taking their own lives and asked us where is the outrage. We have to be the outrage. Presiding officer, in conclusion, we recognise that some people have reasons to doubt their representation in history or to feel left out of Scotland's story. So LGBT History Month provides us an opportunity to reinforce the sense of belonging, representation and value that everyone has a right to feel. We have come a long way towards a more inclusive and equal Scotland where everyone feels safe to be themselves, and all speakers tonight have reminded us there is still yet a lot to do, and I am very sure in this chamber we will all play our part. And can I just finish on the words that Paul O'Kane reminded us? Hope will never be silenced, so let this Parliament never be silenced while we work on this important work. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.